Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. Welcome to part two of the answers to all the wonderful questions you asked to help me celebrate my second anniversary on BookTube. Let's get straight into it. Nathan Fong asked three questions. First, he'd like me to name my top three books ever. I've talked about all of these books quite a bit here, and in fact, when I first started my channel, my husband David more or less asked how long it would be before I made a video that did not mention Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte. I think that was the first grown-up book I ever read. I say grown-up book, but I have been quite surprised to see it shelved in the young adult section sometimes. The first time I saw it there, I rolled my eyes. And then remembered how much I adored the book when I was in that target demographic, which was before YA was really a thing. I guess Jane Eyre does have a special relevance to young readers, partly because it's a bildungsroman, a story about growing up and starting to create oneself, but partly because of its drama and dark romance. The second literary work I love most in the world is one I didn't read until high school. I don't remember if I actually read the book in class. I suspect not, but Antigone by Sophocles was printed in our literature textbook. I'm sure many of you know the story. Antigone is the girl who tries to bury her brother, despite the fact that the king has decreed that her brother should not be buried or even mourned. Antigone breaks his decree, sure that the right thing to do was to follow a higher law, that is, a moral or even a divine law, and give her brother a burial. What impressed me is that Antigone made this choice knowing that the punishment might be death by stoning, but she was so sure she knew what was moral that she was willing to sacrifice her life. And she did not shy away from telling the king that either. I mentioned in my video with Steve Donahue when I had the chance to visit last month that I sometimes think a lot of my personality is shaped by Jane Eyre and Antigone, the plain and quiet character who was still internally fierce despite her shyness, one who insists on her own way and doesn't change her mind ever, and who insists on doing what she thinks is right, even to the point of being pretty darn moralistic and judgmental sometimes. Did these characters feel like soulmates because I recognized them when I first read the books? Or did these characters shape who I became? I'm not sure. Incidentally, I have matured a bit since then, and I am now committed to some core beliefs and actions about patience and tolerance and just basic kindness. But Jane's and Antigone's demons are still my demons, I'm afraid, just as I recognize some of their strengths in myself. Anyway. For the third title in my top three, I'll choose a nonfiction book that had a huge impact on me and helped shape the direction of my career, along with that Helen Keller biography I mentioned in the Q&A part one, Anne Fadiman's book, The Spirit Catches You and You Fall Down, A Hmong Child, Her American Doctors, and the Collision of Two Cultures. The book is at one moment the biography of a family and community, at another, a work of medical anthropology, and at yet another moment, a memoir. It has a lot to say about our current discussion of the importance of patient-centered medical care. It also speaks to the meanings of global immigration, cultural and spiritual identity, and cross-cultural understanding and respect. Basically, The Spirit Catches You, written in 1997, I think, is the story of how Laotian refugees in California interact with the American healthcare system. When young Leah Lee is diagnosed with severe epilepsy, the Hmong immigrants see her case very differently from the way the doctors trained in allopathic medicine do. Leah Lee's community sees the little girl through a spiritual lens, while the physicians analyze her disorder through a scientific one. The cultural dissonance is the source of misunderstandings and distrust, which eventually obstruct her treatment and lead to tragic results. The book argues forcefully that physicians must try to comprehend how their patients understand their own illnesses, not simply because it's the respectful thing to do, but because it's essential in order to provide adequate care. The book ends with the recognition that doctors view their goal to be the saving of the patient's life, while the Hmong immigrants view the ultimate goal to be saving of her soul. Fatima treads lightly here, showing how hard the doctors work to cure Lia Lee, even while pointing out the enormous flaws in their treatment. She shows the love and deep-seated commitment of the family, while never suggesting that their proposed animal sacrifices would have been effective at saving Lia Lee's life. In short, all characters here are complex and thoughtfully drawn. It's a deep analysis of the necessity for an awareness of the clash of cultures and how to move forward. Nathan's second question asked me to name favorite authors, one male and one female. I think my favorite 19th century female author is George Eliot. My favorite 20th century female authors are Eudora Welty and Toni Morrison. And my favorite contemporary or living female author is probably Marilynne Robinson. On some days, I'm sure I would say A.S. Byatt. The two authors have such different styles, but I love them both. And I'm a huge fan of both Jessamyn Ward and Jacqueline Woodson when it comes to younger authors. You did say one female author, right? As for a male author, I really love everything I've read by Thomas Hardy, which now includes all of his major novels, I think. Ian Forster is a close second. And Nathan's last question is, who has been the biggest influence on my reading life? This is actually quite a hard question. Both of my parents really helped create my love of reading, but they did it in very different ways. I mentioned my mother's books in my room earlier in the Q&A. My mother taught high school English and then introductory college writing, and she stored many of the classic novels she had taught on the upper shelves in my bedroom. When I was bored, I climbed up on my desk so I could reach the books up high. Recently, I told Steve Donahue that I would sneak down classic books from her shelves, and he pointed out that she probably didn't mind at all. I'm sure he's correct, and I didn't even feel I was breaking any rules. I don't think she put them there specifically so I would read them. I think it was just an open bookshelf, which was pretty hard to come by in our house. However, I chose to parent with her trick in mind, leaving books not totally obvious places for Abe to pick up whenever he wanted entertainment. I was about to say that the strategy worked, but I have a feeling he would have become a reader no matter what I did. My mother also had a habit of reading everything she could get her hands on about any given topic, whether it was gardening or learning disabilities or embroidery or the stock market. I definitely got that bug of thinking about books in large sets and of feeling like I should read all or at least several books by each author I like, etc. My father was probably the bigger reader even back then, although I'm not sure I realized it at first. He listened to a ton of music and knew so much about jazz and folk music and all the differences between various recordings of Brahms or Mahler or whoever when led by different conductors. He knew an enormous amount about old movies, too. And although he read literature quite widely, he was even more committed to academic history, both as a reader and as a writer. And that is why I think he had the bigger impact on me as a reader, perhaps. When I was in late elementary school, I watched him write a book. From the research and the initial drafting, through the content editing, to the work of preparing it for publication with a university press. Obviously, these lessons inspired me to become a writer, but they also helped me understand far more about books in general, how they've been produced, and how much authors put into them. Even the fact that authors can often recite long paragraphs from their work because they're so intimately involved in the writing for such a long period of time. It was watching him that I realized that authors don't just accidentally say things. Yes, sometimes they don't intend precisely what we see, or they might not fully understand what they produced even, but so much has gone into their final version. The idea of reading in order to understand everything an author is trying to do in a book is absolutely an interest and a skill I have because of my father. Penny G writes, I love to listen to you read. I remember reading to my children when they were small. Did you have a favorite book you read to your son when he was small? I'll name a couple. Some of you who watched my reads and rambles about my family's trip to Boston might guess my first answer. I used to love to read Make Way for Ducklings, a classic picture book by Robert Lawson, to my son, partly because I loved the book so much and wanted to share it with him, and partly because I remembered it so well from when I was young. Actually, I don't remember my parents reading it to me, but I remember reading it aloud to them, and I have such vivid memories of my father reading it to my young brother. He must have read it a zillion times. What I remember most is my father changing every place name and every personal name to something from our own community. For example, there's a scene when Lawson lists all the ducklings with their rhyming, alphabetically ordered names. Dad would choose one of my brother's young playmates and riff off versions of that child's name instead. Maybe Mark, Nark, Oark, Park, Quark, etc. My brother would completely melt down. No, that's not right! Eventually, he got so frustrated, he would grab the book and say, fine, I'll just read it myself. I never really played that game with my son, I don't think, and I'm not sure why I didn't. Another book I used to love to read to Abe and then love to hear him chime in for all the repeated and predictable lines was the picture book Something from Nothing by Phoebe Gilman. The book is an adaptation of a Jewish folktale, very much about making do with what we have, not throwing things away, but adapting them as they become worn. In the book, a young boy's grandfather makes a blanket for him when he's a baby. As the years go by, the grandfather transforms the worn blanket into other things, a jacket, a vest, a tie, a handkerchief, and finally a button. Just thinking about it makes me smile, and I can hear my son, quote, reading that title, Something from Nothing by Phoebe Gilman. So funny. Penny G asks another question. If zombies, or fires, or floods, or pandemics are upon us, and you only have room for one book to cram in your backpack as you're running out the back door, which book would you choose? Penny is not asking for a favorite book necessarily, but one I could read again and again and never tire of. Well, I'd probably grab the Bible. Let me say here that I am really not religious. I sometimes describe myself as a Jewish atheist with Quaker tendencies. So the particular Bible I would choose might be surprising. I'd like to have the King James with me for the history and for the poetry of its translation. My current personal copy of the King James Version is an Oxford World Classics paperback, and I can imagine I might want a hardback with me if I'm going to have to read it over and over again. So I guess I might pick up my hardback New Oxford Annotated Bible instead, with the New Revised Standard Translation. Luckily, both are shelved next to each other on the bookshelf, closest to the front door, all ready to add to my bug-out bag when I'm escaping the zombies. The Quiet Midden asks a lovely question. Let me read it to you. You've shared many clips of gorgeous, peaceful nature settings. What's your favorite spot? Why is it your favorite? And what's your favorite nature setting in a work of fiction? I don't think I've ever shown footage of my own personal favorite spots, actually. I think I would pick out a couple of spots along the coast of South Carolina. The point at the end of Polly's Island, where the ocean meets the marsh, and where sand has accreted over my lifetime to create many additional acres of beach since I was young. I spent many summers in that general area, walking on that beach with both my grandmothers and my parents when they were still pretty young themselves. I remember being at Polly's during the U.S. Bicentennial celebration in 1976, shooting Roman candles into the air and seeing their reflections in the ocean. The second place is very nearby that first spot. This one in Murrells Inlet, where I went crabbing with my granny off a tiny pier extending into the marsh, where I rode around in a little boat with my cousins, and where my family scattered my father's ashes in the water, shaded by bent trees covered in Spanish moss. Actually, I'll choose one more place, not in the Carolinas. When David and I were first dating, and then several times afterwards, we traveled to see his family over Thanksgiving and often went hiking at a small little mountain near his home, right outside New York City, Bear Mountain. And when we drive north now to drop our son off at college or to go meet Steve Donahue, we sometimes drive fairly near it. It's a lovely spot, especially in the autumn, and it has a lot of romantic history for us. Maybe we can stop sometime and go for a walk. As for a favorite natural setting in fiction, I might have to circle back to Thomas Hardy's Wessex and Arthur Ransom's Lake District in Swallows and Amazons, which I mentioned last time. I also remember some amazing descriptions of whales in one of the Darkest Rising books, that children's series by Susan Cooper. I barely remember the plots of those books, but the settings have really stuck with me. As for American books, I'll name two. I think John Steinbeck is a master at describing parts of the West. And I adore the setting in Gloria Naylor's novel, Mama Day, on an island off the coast of South Carolina and Georgia. Naylor paints an atmosphere that I recognize, but that's also almost enchanted. To be honest, I don't love that book the way I did when I was in my early 20s. But the place, the natural world of the book, is beautiful. James Holder asks, how many books do you have in your collection and how do you organize them? I really have no idea how many books I own, and I think I might be embarrassed to admit it if I did know. I made a video last year where I talked a little about the books behind me and then showed you a lot of my collection downstairs. I think in that video I mentioned that while I'm a huge believer in and user of the local public library, I nevertheless own enough books to see me and my neighbors through the coming apocalypse, or those zombies if necessary. There are definitely stacks of books in random corners and stored in boxes, especially books I collected when my son Abe was homeschooling, which I want to give to younger homeschoolers. The pandemic made it hard to get that distribution project going back when I boxed up the books, and I'm afraid I haven't tried lately to make any progress now that things have eased up a bit. But many parts of my library are organized, more or less. I split books up by country of origin of the author, then arrange them by author, shelved in rough chronological order of author's dates. And when I know them off the cuff, without looking it up, I put individual authors' works in basic order of publication, but I'm not rigorous about that. In some sections of my personal shelves, I've interspersed novels with biographies of the author of those novels, or other nonfiction studies of those novels and authors. That's true for canonical American fiction, for example. But then there are other places where I keep all literary biographies separate from the novels, like for Victorian Britain. Perhaps someday I'll work towards consistency, but probably not. My library is not so enormous that I can't figure out where a book is in just a couple of tries, and usually I know exactly where the book is the first time. I love this next question. Sandy at Miss Reads a Lot asks where I get all my wonderful headscarves. Well, I love to pick up scarves at thrift stores, and my husband was kind enough to pick up years ago a huge bag of pretty adventurous scarves when someone held an estate sale for their elderly grandmother or something. But many of my scarves are from a great little online retailer called Rapunzel. Rapunzel starting with a W. When I first started wearing headscarves, for reasons I can't exactly explain, I followed two observant Jewish women, Orthodox women, who had channels on YouTube that showed people how to use scarves to cover their hair. One lived in Baltimore, very close to where I live, and the other somewhere in Canada. Wildly, within a couple of years, the one from Canada moved to Baltimore, to the same basic neighborhood as the other women, and soon they opened an online store where they sold not only scarves, but pins and earrings, etc. They also started a Facebook group for women who rapped, and very quickly, a community of rappers gathered online there, again with a W, posting pictures of their raps almost every day, as well as talking about all the different reasons people chose to wear scarves. There were many observant Jewish women, but also Muslim women and Catholics and Mormons and Orthodox Christians, cancer survivors, which I later became, and feminists who changed things around to use modesty as a form of resistance to the commodification of women's bodies. It would be false of me to say that was my clear reason for starting, but it was not totally alien to my thinking either. Anyway, the online community, which is restricted to people who define themselves as women or as feminine, was from all over the globe and felt like one of the safest places I'd ever seen to talk with people who have radically different perspectives on the world. I think that amazing community has produced a lot of people very loyal to the Rapunzel retailers, and I am certainly one of them. They, of course, sell to anyone, even if you're not in the Facebook group, and their scarves in general are great for wearing around your neck if you prefer. I'll leave a link to their online store down in the description box. So, here's something I'm planning. At some point, I want to do a very different kind of wrap-up from the usual kind featured on BookTube. I want to demonstrate how I wrap my scarves. Is that too crazy? Several people have asked me how I do it. If you're not at all interested, I'll make it very clear what is going on so you can skip that video easily. Right now, I think I'll try to make it and post it during Bookica. Hannah's Bookica, by the way, is sort of my short version of Vlogmas. My goal will be to post for each of the nights of Hanukkah, that is, 8 nights in a row. This year, Hanukkah falls very early, starting at the end of November. Well, this is getting rather long, so I'll film the next set of answers in another video, perhaps tomorrow or the next day. Thank you so much for asking these great questions and for joining me here today on Hannah's Books. See you soon.